morning again. I want to welcome everyone who's watching us today, those who are listening. We're in week 8 of a teaching series where we've been teaching through the life of Christ, beginning with just the very beginning of his adult ministry as he was baptized in the Jordan River by John, going right on up through his death. One of the things that we have said throughout this series is that Jesus didn't come to make something that was already there better, but that he had come to introduce something brand new into the world and for the world. So let's jump right back into the story. When we left off last week, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover with his guys. And Passover was a big deal because Passover is an annual celebration where all of the Jewish people would get together and celebrate the fact that God had delivered their ancestors from slavery in Egypt. But the celebration was a little bit muted in the first century because the Jews were not free. They were subjects to Rome. And so while they were celebrating their freedom in the past, they couldn't celebrate their freedom now. And it was a big deal, though. And Jerusalem was definitely the place to be at Passover. So if you can get the picture, Jerusalem is this large city and it's at feast time, and thousands of Jewish pilgrims were also pouring into town. So every road is packed and the city is crowded and all of the homes and the places to stay are full. And Jesus and his guys have kind of joined this crowd of people who are moving towards the city. Scripture tells us that the chief priests and the Pharisees and the keepers of the temple, they've heard that Jesus is coming to Jerusalem. And they're thinking, this is the opportunity to get him. If only we can find him in the crowd. And the chief priests and the temple leaders had given orders to anyone that if they saw Jesus to report it so that they might arrest him. But they didn't want to arrest him during the time of the festival because they were afraid that the people might riot. So he's somewhere in the city, and we'll find him, and so keep an eye on him. And then when the festival is over, we'll move in and separate him from the crowd, and we'll arrest him, and we'll have him put to death. And then we'll send someone to get Lazarus, and we'll put him to death as well. And then this whole thing will be over with. The scriptures say that about 5 days before the actual Passover, the people are out looking for Jesus. And they begin to hear that Jesus is on the way, and he's been kind of staying on the move and traveling into the little towns and villages in the area there, so they really don't know which way he's coming from, and they're not sure, but there's this buzz, and the whole city is expecting Jesus, and they're thinking that this may be the moment, that this will be the Passover, when the Messiah steps up and liberates them from Rome. So Rome is nervous. And the religious leaders are nervous, and the Pharisees are nervous, and everybody is on the lookout for Jesus. And they spot him coming. And when they see him in a distance, a word begins to spread, and the people begin to line up on each side of the road, and they take branches from the palm trees, and they go out to meet him, and they begin to wave them in the air and then lay them in the road, and they begin shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna," which means save us now. They were not celebrating because Jesus was the Savior of the world. They were calling for him to literally save them from Rome. And in the next few days, what Jesus would do would be so confusing that they wouldn't understand it. When they begin to see that Jesus was not coming to liberate them from Rome, and if he was not going to do that, what good was he to them? And so in a few days, the shouts are going to turn from Hosanna, Hosanna, to crucify him, crucify him. So for the next few days, Jesus is kind of moving around the city, kind of secretly, and he's laying low, and he's moving around at night, and there's a Jesus sighting over here, and there's a Jesus sighting over there, and by the time they get there, Jesus is gone, and he even goes to the temple, and he teaches for a little while, but he leaves before they can arrest him. And then 2 days out from Passover, something that would have seemed miraculous to them took place. The guys that had been looking for Jesus finally caught a break. Because one of the closest followers of Jesus breaks rank with the group. The scriptures say that Judas went to the chief priests and the officers of the temple guard and discussed with him how he might betray Jesus. And the text says that they were delighted. So he agreed and began looking for an opportunity to betray Jesus so that they could arrest him when the crowds were not around. The reason why those who wanted Jesus arrested were delighted is because they were actually afraid. They were afraid that if Jesus became king, they would lose everything that was valuable to them, their power, their influence, and that he would take their things away. And maybe that's why some of you who are watching or listening today have been afraid to make Jesus the king of your life, because you're afraid of what he might take away. But as they were about to discover, Jesus had not come to take anything away. Jesus had come to give something. So now their plan is set in motion. And the stage is set for the battle of the ages, the kingdom of this world versus the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of this world, with its top-down arrangement, with its violence-based arrangement, with its we can handle things, we can control things, with its might makes right, against the kingdom of God. And their plan was actually going to succeed, but what they wanted to accomplish would not succeed. Because unlike them, Jesus did not cling to his life. It was his intention all along to give his life away. But before he did that, there were a couple of loose ends that he needed to tie up. And the Passover meal, and the Passover was the perfect time to do that. So he sends some of his guys out into the city to find a place where he and his disciples, the 12, can celebrate the Passover meal together. A place where they wouldn't be interrupted, a place where he wouldn't be arrested, a place where no one would find them, and where they could have some peace and where they could have some conversation, because Jesus knows that his time is drawing near. And as they begin the Passover meal, something happens that the disciples did not fully understand until after the resurrection of Jesus. Because while they're having their meal, Jesus took some bread. And Scripture says it was unleavened bread, so it didn't have the material in it to cause it to rise. It was kind of like a flat piece of bread, almost like a cracker. And Scripture says that when he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to them. And he said, "Take and eat. This is my body." And that just had to mess them up. But he wasn't finished. He said, "Do this in remembrance." To which they would have said, "You don't have to tell us what we need to do this in remembrance of. We've been doing this every year for hundreds of years. We do this in remembrance of God coming to Egypt and taking our people out. We do this in remembrance of God punishing the nation of Egypt and punishing Pharaoh. And we know exactly what we're going to do this in remembrance of." And Jesus said, "All of this is changing. Now you are to do this in remembrance of me." And they may have thought, "Okay, Jesus, you've contradicted Moses. You've said that you're greater than the temple, and now you're changing the Passover." But that wasn't all. Because the Scripture says that after the meal, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is," and they maybe thought, "Wait a minute, we know what this cup is. This cup represents the blood that was shed by animals the night that our ancestors left Egypt and went to the promised land. And they had to kill a spotless lamb, and they put the blood over the door and on the sides of the door. And we all left under the blood of the lamb, and we went to Mount Sinai, and God established us as a new nation. We know what the cup means." But Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people." You see, before when you did this, it was a celebration of the fact that God had established a brand new relationship with the nation of Israel. But from now on, whenever you take this cup, you are going to celebrate a brand new covenant that begins tonight, that night. In fact, about 650 years before that night, the prophet Jeremiah wrote this. He said, "The day is coming when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah. And this covenant will not be like the one I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and brought them out of the land of Egypt. The covenant that God had established with Moses when he came down with the Ten Commandments and with all of the rituals and all of the rules and all of the conditions. Will this new covenant be like the old one?" And Jeremiah says that this is the new covenant that I will make. I will put my instructions deep within them, and I will write them on their hearts. This is not going to be some laws that are written on tablets of stone. This time I will write it on their hearts. This is not going to be a covenant where they have to memorize a bunch of laws and rules. This is going to be a covenant of conscience. This had been promised hundreds of years before this night with Jesus and his disciples. And Jesus says that this new covenant that was promised a long time ago, one that you should have been looking for, one that is going to begin, right now, that this is a new covenant. And it's a new relationship, not between God and a nation, but between God and the nations. Not between God and a group of people, but between God and individual people. Now, let's pause a minute in our story for a few minutes and just get some definition and some context. A covenant simply means an arrangement. It's an agreement. It's an agreement between two parties. And basically, when you study ancient culture, there are three types of covenants that kind of dominated the landscape there. The first is what is called a bilateral parity treaty. Now, there's not going to be a test on this, but you really need to pay attention. So, a bilateral parity treaty is an agreement between two equals. It's an I will if you will, and you will if I will, and if you don't, I won't kind of thing. It's two people or two groups that are equal, and they come up with a contract that they can both agree to, but it was a contract or a covenant between two equals. And then there's what bilateral suzerainty treaty. And this is between a king or a very powerful person and someone who has lesser power, someone who does not have much choice in the matter. It's kind of like a parent who owns the car and has the keys to the car, and they tell their teenage son or daughter, here are my keys. I'm going to let you drive my car, but I expect you to be home at 10, and no speeding, and no giving rides, and no eating in the car. And the kid has to say okay, because they really don't have much power in this agreement. And the parent has all the power. Now here's what you need to know about that. God's relationship with the nation of Israel was a bilateral suzerainty treaty. God said to the nation of Israel at Mount Sinai, here's the rules. Here's the rules. And God dictated all of the terms. And so Moses came down from Mount Sinai. He had all of these rules and all of these conditions and all of these rituals and all of these punishments. And if you would like to read all of them, you can find them at the end of the book of Exodus and all of Leviticus and most of Deuteronomy. And you remember those are the parts of the Bible that you usually fall asleep during. But they're really important. But not for us, because we're not a part of ancient Israel. And that's why when you read them, you're like, who in the world would do this stuff? And it's complicated, but it's important. You see, God was starting a nation. He was founding a group of people that had to have some rules and laws. And He was starting with an I will if you will covenant. He was starting with a if you don't, then I won't type of covenant. And you can read this over and over again in the Old Testament. God would say things like, do not worship other gods. Obey my commands, and I will keep you safe, and your crops will grow. But if you don't, if you go off and worship other gods, if you disobey my commands, I'll remove my protection from you, and your crops won't grow. And you can follow ancient Israel's history through the Old Testament like this. It's kind of like a circular thing. They honor God for a while, and they're blessed, and then they begin to forget. And they start to follow other gods, and so God removes His blessing, and they suffer for it. And they finally, you know, call on God again, and the cycle starts again. And it's kind of this roadmap of the history of the nation of Israel, and this is what you get when you have a bilateral suzerainty covenant. But there is a third type of covenant, and it's called a promissory covenant. And this one, and this is so important, it's an agreement where one party binds itself to an obligation for the benefit of the other party. One party binds itself to an obligation. It makes a promise to the other party that is for the benefit of the other party. It's not an I will if you will and I won't if you won't. So it's not bilateral. It's what we call unilateral. It's unconditional. It's all one-sided. Now, here's where it gets a little bit weird, okay? Now, in ancient covenants, they were all ratified in pretty much the same way. And I know this is kind of strange to us, but this was years ago and how the culture did it. And so it's strange and somewhat messy. But if you wanted to make a deal with someone, something had to die. And generally what they did is they would take an animal, depending on how wealthy the parties were, sometimes multiple animals, and they would literally, after they killed them, they would literally cut them right down the middle. and they would lay the body open on the ground, and then each party making the covenant together would literally walk through the halves of this dead animal together. And I know this is really strange to us, but remember, this is how people in ancient times dealt with things, and it would be really weird today. And I just thought, just think of going and buying a car and or a house, and you got to kill an animal and walk through it, and it's just kind of crazy. In fact, have you ever heard the term, we're going to cut a deal? This is where this came from. It's an ancient custom in the Middle East. And what you're saying is this, that if you make this agreement, what you're saying is, may it be unto me as it is for this most unfortunate animal if I violate the terms of this covenant. In other words, I'm pledging my life. I'm going to keep this covenant. And that was how the parity and the suzerainty covenants were marked. Well, this is so interesting, because when someone made a promissory covenant, they would slice the animal just like before, but instead of both parties walking between them, only one party would walk between the halves of the animal. Why? Because only one party is making the unconditional promise to keep their part of this covenant. Now, back to our story. That night at Passover, as God was establishing a whole new covenant with the world, what kind of covenant was it going to be? Well, Jesus answered it. He said, "This bread is my body. This cup is my blood. I'm taking on the role of the sacrifice." And they may have been thinking, okay, well, that's your part, but what's our part? And he says, oh no, this is my blood which is poured out for you. So here's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, there's a new covenant tonight. I'm the representative of God's side of this, and you're on the receiving side. Or another way of saying it is, this is 100% for you, and it's 100% on me. And Matthew's account of this adds these words. Jesus said, this cup is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. And it is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. And you got to put yourself in the room with his guys. And they're trying to follow this. So Jesus, you're telling us that you're establishing a new covenant that Jeremiah prophesied. And this new covenant is going to be a promissory agreement, and you're representing God's part. So from now on, when we gather, we're not celebrating God's delivering our people from Egypt. From now on, we're going to celebrate this new covenant. But Jesus, the blood part is throwing us, because remember, most of what Jesus told these guys didn't make a whole lot of sense until after the resurrection. But what do you mean the covenant is in your blood? How is that possible? I mean, Jesus, right now, you're the most popular person in this city. People are looking for you. They want to be around you. I mean, people are waiting for you to step up during Passover and proclaim yourself king. And now you're telling us that you are taking the place of what happens at the temple, where we go and we provide an animal and the blood of the animal is shed to cover our sins. And you're going to do that? And not just an every year kind of sacrifice, but you're going to do this one time? For the whole world? You know, they should have seen this coming. Because day one, when Jesus stepped into the pages of history as an adult, John the Baptist, looking to this very moment, 3 years earlier, said to the crowd who had gathered at the Jordan River, look, there's the Lamb of God who is going to take away the sins of the entire world. And now the next day after this Passover meal, the new covenant is going to be ratified with Roman nails and Roman steel. And this new covenant is not just going to be for a few chosen people and one chosen nation. This new covenant that's going to be ratified at this Passover is going to be for everyone in the world, for every generation, for all of time. And this is the big one, the final one, the everlasting one that would fulfill God's promise to Abraham and replace God's covenant with Israel. And it was an unconditional covenant. It was a promissory covenant. And I think that if we were there and we'd say, John, this just sounds too good to be true. I mean, it's too good to believe that God established a relationship with me through Jesus the Son, and that he forgave all of my sins, and that it was unilateral, that he did the whole thing, and that it really was all for me. And it was really all on him. And we would say, but John, what do we do? What is our part in this? And I think that John, who sat there that night and heard all of this, and John, who later watched Jesus die, and Jesus, who 3 days, and John, who 3 days later looked into an empty tomb, and John, who had breakfast with Jesus on the beach, and John, who gave his life so that the world would know that God had done something for the world. If we were to say, John, how do I get in on that? How do I respond? If it's for me, how do I make it mine? I think that John would say it in the very best way that he could. He would say, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but would have eternal life. That whoever would believe in him would not be left out of the covenant, but they would be a part of that eternal covenant. And they would have not just life, but eternal life. I mean, who wouldn't want to get in on that? And then we could ask Peter and we'd say, Peter, this sounds too good to be true. How do I get in on that? And Peter would tell us about the day that he met Jesus, and Jesus said, let's go fishing. And here's what you need to do, Peter. You need to let down your nets in deeper water and all of this. And Peter would say, we caught so many fish that we didn't know what to do with them. And Peter would tell us that he realized there was something special about this man. And Peter would say that Jesus told him, Peter, here's what I want you to do. I want you to follow me. To follow me. And that is the invitation of the new covenant. And it still stands today. Jesus simply asked us to follow him. He did not say, obey me. He did not say, worship me. He said, follow me. And you may be watching or listening right now, and you may be thinking, but Jerry, it can't be that simple. And I would tell you it is just that simple. But Jerry, there's got to be more to it than that. Nope. You're just used to how you've been treated by the other people that you know. But this is what Jesus, this is why Jesus said, God is your perfect heavenly Father. That's why Jesus said, it's as simple as believing that it's true. And then it becomes that for all of you. It is God loved and God gave. And our part is to believe and receive. And it's just that simple. So on that night, Jesus made it clear that he had come to replace something that had been in place. And here's the part that we have a hard time getting our arms around. And this is the part that may disturb you, and I hope so. But Jesus came to replace everything from the beginning of Exodus through the end of Malachi. That we are done with that. So there's a new covenant in town. But there's one more loose end that Jesus has to tie up. And that's why I want you to not miss next week. I want you to tell a friend and have them join with us at this same time next week. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for our time together this morning. And it's been strange and it's been awkward. But God, we've been able to sing praises to you, not just here, but all around the world. And people sitting in their homes and gathering with their families and hearing the Word of God taught. And God, we've heard the greatest message that we'll ever hear. That because God loved each of us so much that he gave his one and only son, that if we would believe, we would receive eternal life. And that that's not just for a select few, but that's for anyone in the world. And nothing could be more right and nothing could be more fair. So Father, we're thankful for that. We're thankful for the opportunity to do this. I'm thankful for our band and for our tech crew that showed up this morning. We're able to do this. I'm thankful for all of our people out there, both our church family and those who are brand new to us today. God, we're going to need your wisdom in the days ahead. Help us to turn inward towards our family, turn inwards to the people that we care deeply for, and then, Father, turn outwards and ask that great question, how can I help of everyone that we see? God, be with the leaders of our nation, be with the leaders of our state, be with the leaders in our area. Give them wisdom to know just exactly what to do to lead us in the right way. But Father, today we don't want to leave before letting you know that we're so thankful for Jesus and for what he's done for us. God, we're thankful that he came to do away with a system of sacrifice that really wasn't very fair. There were people who could do certain things and other things that other people couldn't do. And he simply said this, if you'll just believe that my son is who he said he is, that he's the son of God, that he sent from heaven. And that his death forgives our sins, that the shedding of his blood forgives our sins. And you believe, then you can receive eternal life and spend eternity together. Father, we are so thankful for that. We're looking forward to a time when we can gather again. But until then, we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. One real quick announcement. We have our information up there. And I wanted to just say, if you have any special needs, if you have a prayer request, if there is anything that we can do for you, any questions that you may have, the best way to get a hold of us is by email at AtlanticCoastChurch@gmail.com. But we're also on all of the other social media there, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. If you would like to share this, this will be on our Facebook page for the next couple of days, and then we'll move it to our YouTube page. Hit the subscribe button because we've got a lot of things coming out that I think are going to help us. But anyway, thank you for watching today. God bless you guys and be good to each other.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing.